every single thing that you've gone through equips you to be able to do what you were born to do.
Welcome back to the Find Your Purpose Now podcast. We are all about finding and living the purpose for which we were born and perfectly matched, because life is so much better when we're doing that. We're happier. We feel more fulfilled. Depression just melts away. Like you can't be living your purpose and be depressed. It doesn't mean that you can't be sad. Of course, things happen and you know, some of them are sad. But you can't be depressed, sad for an extended period of time and also be living your purpose, because when you live your purpose is accompanied with joy and good feelings about yourself. Like, you know that you're good at what you do when you're living your purpose, and you know that you're doing something good in the world when you're living your purpose. It just makes a lot of the bad feelings that we experience disappear. And it's not magic. It's just like when you put a key in the lock. When you try to force a key that doesn't fit in the lock, nothing happens. The door doesn't open. But when you get the right key, put the right key in the lock, you can feel it click into place. And you turn the key and the lock opens and the door opens. And that's how it feels when you wake up in the morning and know that you know that you know that you're living in your purpose. You're doing what you're supposed to do. So I started a series last time of questions that we should be asking ourselves, kind of, you know, on a pretty regular basis, because if we're learning and we're growing, every time we answer these questions, we could have different answers, because hopefully we've learned something. Hopefully we've matured. Hopefully we've acquired wisdom that we didn't have before. So don't just blow this off and go, yeah, yeah, I've done that. I've done all that. Well, not where you are right now. Emotionally, intellectually, spiritually, in every way. So I want to pick up where we left off last week. But before I do, I just want to talk to you a little bit about the questions that we ask ourselves. You know, we have a tendency to get, it's almost like a tunnel vision. We're going down the road. You know, let's say you got your first job out of school in a certain industry. You're still in that industry. And you're asking yourself, okay, well, should I stay at this job or should I take this other job? And I just want to challenge you a little bit, because I think we tend to ask very limited questions. Maybe the question isn't, do you take this job or that job at all? Maybe that's not the question. Maybe that's not the industry. Maybe there's something completely different for you. So if you stay in this, I'll just say tunnel. If you just stay in this tunnel of only asking questions that are, you know, sort of right in front of you, you might miss something. And the saddest thing is to miss the big thing because you're focused on some little thing. It's like getting, you know, spending a ton of time fixing something that you don't need to be doing at all. Learning some skill in this industry, and I'm all about learning new things, don't get me wrong, but sometimes we spend an awful lot of time learning something, fixing something, trying to get something right that doesn't have to be done at all. That's the worst waste of time possible. So in this process of, you know, asking questions and answering questions, I hope that you'll give yourself the time. Really carve out time, even if it's 5 minutes in the morning or 5 minutes before you go to sleep at night. Give yourself some time where you just turn the phone off, turn all the electronics off, have some quiet, and really think about the answers to these questions. And also, think about what other questions you should be asking yourself. I mean, one question might trigger something else in your mind. Go there. Let yourself go there. What if you decided to pursue a childhood dream? A lot of people think that the stuff that they thought about in childhood was just, you know, it was just a dream and it wasn't real, you know. I mean, how many little boys become firemen and little girls become ballerinas or whatever? I mean, it's kind of a cliched example, but you get my point. But there might be some aspect of what you wanted to do when you were younger that actually is part of what you're supposed to be doing. Okay, so picking up from the questions where I left off last time, ask yourself, what would you do if you were not afraid? What do you think is important for you to do, or that you were made to do, you would like to do, but you're afraid of doing it for whatever reason? You could be afraid that there's going to be some negative judgment on you. Somebody's not going to like it. Somebody's going to be disappointed or embarrassed or, you know, whatever. Think through the why behind your fear. You might just carry that on and say, well, what if I went ahead and did it? Afraid. Lots of us do things that we're afraid of, and you know, most of us live through it. I'm talking about, for example, you know, I was scared out of my wits, I think, the first time that I was asked to come and speak in front of a group. It turned out to be a really large group. When I said yes, I thought it was going to be a small group. It turned out to be like 900 people or whatever. And I was so afraid. Thankfully, the person who asked me to do it was somebody that I would just about do anything for. So I said yes. And it wound up opening an amazing door for me. I've had the opportunity to speak to, oh gosh, tens of thousands of people since that day. If I hadn't been willing to do something, or try to do something that I was afraid to do, I wouldn't have had all those opportunities, and I wouldn't have met all the amazing people that accompanied those opportunities. So I'm glad that I pushed through the fear. So I want to encourage you to push through your fear. So the next question, is there something you would do if you knew that you couldn't fail? What would you do if you knew that you could not fail? Really think that through. And then give yourself permission to use that imagination that you were gifted. I think, you know, a lot of us, we grow out of our childhood and we think, it's just childish to have a daydream about, you know, what life would be like if I were a professional ballerina, whatever, you know, and we don't give ourselves the luxury of actually thinking something through like that. And I want to encourage you to do it. So, you know, okay, if you could do something and you knew you wouldn't fail at it, what would it be? And then take it a step further. What would it feel like? What would that feel like to you? I mean, imagine yourself walking through that day. And the reason that I'm saying this is that, you know, we might decide in thinking through what that day or what that experience would be like that we really wouldn't like it. I know that was my experience when I was much younger. I thought that I wanted to be a prosecutor. And I just was gung-ho that I was going to be a prosecutor. And I don't know where I got the idea, but I decided to go talk to somebody in the district attorney's office. I don't know. I think I was 17 years old or something. It's kind of amazing that they even, that, you know, somebody agreed to talk to me. But, you know, I just ask, okay, well, what's it like? And do you like it? What's the best part of it? What's the worst part of it? You know, what do you wish you would have known before you, you know, launched into this career? And by the end of that one conversation, I knew that I couldn't be a prosecutor. So the idea that I had in my mind about the thing I thought that I would do if money weren't an object, if, you know, all these different things that I knew I couldn't fail or whatever, turns out that I would be miserable doing that. In my particular situation, for a lot of reasons, one would be when the person said, oh, it's awful when you don't get the conviction, when you know that this person is guilty and they wind up going free for some reason, you know, and I'm thinking to myself, oh my gosh, I mean, I would be completely inconsolable if I worked super hard and I felt like someone was a danger, especially to children, for example. And that person was walking free. I thought, oh my gosh, I'd wind up committing a crime. You know, I would wind up harming that person. And, you know, so I thought, okay, that's not going to work for me. The reason that this is important to do is that it's almost like when you really think it through and you know that it isn't for you, it's not a waste of time. You basically get it up out of your system. Get it out of your system. It's not your thing. That way, you don't go through your whole life sort of pining for the thing that you didn't get to do, because that will lead you down a path of sort of feeling like a victim. I didn't get that education. I didn't get to do this. I didn't get to do, oh, I didn't, you know. Okay. No. When you really walk that road and figure out, okay, you know what? That's not meant for me. It wouldn't work out well for me. Or the thing that I thought was so great and glamorous. No, it turns out it's not glamorous. It's grueling. That's my example about flying all over everywhere and speaking and doing media and all that kind of stuff. When I started doing it, I actually thought that, oh, what a glamorous life. Oh, it'd be amazing to be on TV. And it would be so awesome to just travel all over and speak to all these different groups. And it is, it's great. But the reality of it is that you can be on an airplane for 5 hours for a 3-minute television segment. You can travel, you know, literally for 19 hours. You can get stuck in airports and, you know, overnight, and there's not a hotel. And, you know, and I mean, it can just be really, really hard for going someplace and doing a 20-minute keynote. I'm not saying don't do it. I'm just saying when you start to ask yourself these questions and really think through what that would be like, you may find out that you no longer think it's the most amazing, glamorous thing that you can't live without. You may wind up thinking, okay, there are these advantages, there are these disadvantages. On balance, I really don't want to do that. On the other side, you might say, oh yeah, I really want to do that. That's what I really want. Okay, well, there you go. Now you've asked a question that took you completely out of this whole, do I stay on this job or take this job? Now you've asked yourself a question that's, you know, up over here somewhere that's completely busted out of the tunnel where you're no longer stuck thinking about one thing and the tiny little differences inside of that one thing. Okay. The next question, what do people come to you for? Do people come to you to vent? Are you a good listener? Do people come to you with complicated issues like work problems, personal problems, relationship problems, financial problems? Do they come to you for, you know, to just kind of help them sort through all of their chaos? Are you the person who can just dial down the noise on chaos and get right to the point and offer meaningful suggestions? Do people come to you to help them do things? Like, are you somebody who can just somehow figure out how to fix stuff? Do you know the right people to refer somebody to? I mean, I could go on and on. What do people typically come to you for? And you can go back and say, okay, well, what did people come to me for when I was younger? What about when I was a kid? Do people come to you because you're fun and the most fun thing to do is to hang out with you or go do something with you? So the reason that it's important to ask that is that what people come to you for or are interested in talking to you about now may be different than what it was just even a few years ago. Ask yourself that on a fairly regular basis. The next one, what compliments did you receive when you were a kid? What compliments did you receive when you were a teenager or when you were a young adult? Think about what people complimented you on. And then peel away the physical appearance compliments and really try to focus on what did people comment, or what character traits did people comment on about you, or the things that you know how to do, your abilities. Think about those compliments, because a lot of times what people observe about us, we dismiss about us because those things come so naturally to us that we don't think they're a big deal. But some of them are a very big deal, and some of them are like a flashing neon light clue to what we should be doing with our lives. Okay, the next question, let's talk about your creativity. Because the way you express your creativity is a huge clue to not only what you are gifted to do, but to what's going to make you feel better. What I'm talking about is that when we engage in our own unique avenues for creativity, we feel better. If, for example, if I'm sad, if I'm depressed, if I'm frustrated, if I'm upset, if I'm angry, any negative emotion, envious, I don't get envious or jealous, you know, very often anymore, but I used to when I would compare myself and always felt like I wasn't good enough and all those kinds of things. But when I started exercising my creativity, something clicked. And I realize now that my best defense against depression, frustration, anger, all the negative emotions is for me to sit down and write. That happens to be my creativity. I can get lost in it. I can go into a rabbit hole and be there for hours and not even realize that hours have gone by. So think about what your creativity is. And it might be different now than what it was 5 years ago, 10 years ago. I know somebody who at 80 took up coloring and loves it and gets lost in it, and it makes her feel good. And so, you know, if you feel like you're not terribly creative or you haven't really given yourself any kind of creative outlet, maybe for a long time, maybe since you were a kid, find something that you want to do. And don't worry about what anybody thinks of it or says about it or whatever. Your creativity can be dance. It can be, oh goodness, it can be singing. It can have something to do with music, writing music, playing music. It can be drawing, crochet, knitting, needlepoint. It can be refinishing an old piece of furniture. Just think about something that you're interested in. If you're not sure what your area of creativity might be, try different things until you find the thing that just clicks for you. I have a friend who decided to become a beekeeper and harvest honey and sell the honey and use the honey to make lip balm and different kinds of products. I mean, it's different, you know, it's a different way of exercising creativity, and it works. So whatever works for you that makes you feel good and doesn't harm anybody else and gives you that opportunity to just express your creativity, do it. Okay. The last one I'm going to share today, what makes you laugh? What are the kinds of things that make you smile, just make you feel lighter? Find those things and then lean into that. And again, don't worry about what anybody thinks or says or whatever. And, you know, if you're concerned that, okay, let's say it's funny cat videos that make you laugh, okay, if you don't want to spend an hour and get lost on Instagram and you don't have time to, you know, lose all that time or whatever, okay, set a timer, give yourself 5 minutes, whatever it is, but whatever makes you laugh, lean into that. Do that. It's so important to laugh every day. There are a lot of, you know, there's science behind it, but I think more than anything is that when we laugh, it's almost like, to me, pulling a plug on pent up frustrations, the ways that we think that we're not enough, the ways that we feel like we failed. And when you're really laughing, when something's really entertaining to you or funny to you, and you can just kind of let yourself go. I mean, if you can find something that you can have a really serious gut laugh over, belly laugh, where it feels like you've done 100 sit-ups after laughing, if you can find that, God bless you. That's amazing. Because when you do that, you pull the plug on all the negativity that you're holding on to. It just flows out. You can't be laughing, really laughing, and be miserable at the same time. There was, I think it was Leo Buscaglia when he was teaching at, I think it was UCLA. I mean, I'm going back to like, I think it was the 70s and 80s or whatever. So check me on this. I could be wrong on my details, but I'm pretty sure it was Leo Buscaglia who did these experiments on laughter with chronically ill people and found that if they could laugh, really laugh for like a few minutes, it gave them pain relief for, I can't remember if it was 3 to 4 times the amount of time that they had laughed. Think about that. If we can literally relieve physical pain with laughter, imagine what we're doing with emotional pain and spiritual pain with laughter. And who knows? I mean, maybe with laughter, with the clues to what make you laugh, the things that just trip your trigger, if you can somehow figure out what you think is fun, what you enjoy doing, what makes you laugh, and figure out how to make a job out of that, how to make work out of that, how to add value to the world doing that and earn an income while you're doing it. Okay, that right there is the best. Think about it. If what you could wake up and go to work and do every day made you smile, is there anything better than that? So, okay, that's it for today. Come back and join me for the next questions that are lining the path toward your purpose and you living your purpose. And listen, if you will do this, if you'll listen to this podcast, if you'll really do the things that we talk about here, 1 year from now, I hope that you're going to be contacting me and telling me about the amazing thing that you're doing and how your life has changed because you're living this purpose-filled life. Your purpose, your specific, unique purpose in the world. And because listen, 1 year from now, you're going to be 1 year older either way. You might as well be a year older and living your best life. And I don't mean that in some cliched way. I mean, literally getting up and doing what you were born to do, what you love to do, what you feel so good about doing. That's what I want for you. Okay, see you next time.
The things that you've been through have changed the way you see the world. They've qualified you to do what you were born to do and perfectly matched to do. Is there anything more important than finding and living the purpose for which you were born? I don't think so. I think that's the point.